Welcome to Interpreting Music, the show in which we take a recent track, react to it, discuss it, and analyze it.
I'm Matt Ferrandino. I have a PhD in music theory.
And I'm Frank Nara. I have a doctorate in music composition.
For today's episode, Frank is going to be sharing the track Latch by Disclosure featuring Sam Smith. After taking a listen in part one, we'll break down the song, its lyrics, history, and cultural context. In part two of the episode, linked in the description, we'll analyze the musical components of the track. Be sure to listen to the entire track, which is linked below.
You lift my heart up when the rest of me is down. You enchant me even when you're not around.
All right. So that was Latch from Sam Smith and Disclosure. This was released in 2013. Disclosure is a production duo out of the UK, and Sam Smith is a singer out of the UK. And this song, to the best of my knowledge, sort of propelled both of their careers into a new stratosphere. After the release of this, both entities kind of got pretty popular. So after an initial listen, you've never heard this song before. What questions do you have? What thoughts do you have about, you know, what's your gut reaction, I guess?
My gut reaction, I mean, the first thing that comes to my mind as I'm sitting here listening to it for the first time, there's a hell of a lot of side chaining going on to the point where it's almost distracting. Like things keep getting like kind of sucked out of the texture and popping back in. It's happening with the drums, it's happening with the synths. And then like, even kind of throughout, despite the subtle texture changes, what does that say?
Compression. I wrote that down too.
Oh, okay. Cause well, you know, you look a little tiny on the side cause you're sharing screen right now. So I wasn't sure what it said. But yeah. So there's this like, kind of, it's almost like this secondary rhythmic element, because you've got the beat going on, right, kind of in the background, but then you've got kind of this almost timbral popping with the EQ, which kind of has its own kind of, you know, kind of like a kick, snare, low, high thing going on. So since you happen to write down compression, what were your thoughts on that? I mean, that's the first thing that I take away from this first listen.
Yeah. So yeah, like I think, not being an expert in dance music at all, observing some of the pop tunes that are clearly inspired by EDM recently, like some Lady Gaga stuff, K Trinata, etc., I hear that pumping very prominently. Like if I listen close enough, I can hear it in a lot of different tracks because it's a thing, you know, master compression, sidechain compression. But I think that pumping that is introduced by a compressor is potentially really important for dance music because like you were saying, it sort of adds a second rhythmic texture. It's like, it's not a polyrhythm per se, but you know, you're getting layers of differing rhythms, and that is sort of a digital rhythm that is getting put into things just from that.
Yeah,
that
I think calling it a timbral rhythm isn't too far off the mark.
I like that, a timbral rhythm. Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder too then, if, you know, obviously listening environment must have an impact on how this is, you know.
Yeah, do you have a subwoofer? I can't recall.
No, I do not.
Yeah, so I do. I'm getting a lot of like monitors.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah. So, I mean, even that kind of, there were some bass notes. I'm like, man, is that, what is that? And like, you know, just doing a quick check on the keyboard, I'm like, man, I can't really tell. And it's like, you know, this kind of like really low, like, you know, sub.
Yes.
Sound.
Yes.
Which certainly has an effect, but I'm also thinking that it has an impact on, you know, probably the feel. If it's, you know, massive speakers, big subwoofers in a big room, in like
you're going to feel that.
You're going to feel it, but you're also probably hearing things a lot differently than like listening in headphones or earbuds or, you know, even just, you know, home speakers or something. So yeah. I think this is true of like all EDM from, you know, from the early 90s up, that listening environments, it's changes a lot of the sort of aesthetic of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And this was actually, I think, my loudest listen ever. So that actually, and that's why I wrote it down in big letters, because like, dang, I need to bring that up, compression, because I had noticed it, but this was my loudest listen thus far, and I really noticed it, because I got a big old subwoofer down here, and so yeah, if you're in a club, and again, I to the best of my knowledge, you know, Disclosure, they are a production duo. They create music explicitly for clubs, for dancing, hence electronic dance music, EDM, right? So when they're making production choices, they have that in mind. Whereas like, you know, your album that I recently worked on mixing, helping you mix and stuff, like I would never do that for a rock song. Because like a recorded rock song, you're not expecting like a crowd of people to be dancing to it in a club. Mm-hmm. That's just not a thing, really. I mean,
I mean, generally when you're mixing a rock album, right, you want to try to capture a live
sound,
even though, I mean, that's kind of the industry standard, I guess you could say, or the expectation for a rock song, right? It sounds like going to see a rock band rather than going to an EDM club or going to a discotheque or something.
Yeah, exactly. So if I put in, because all throughout your album that I worked on, there is a ton of sidetrain compression. There's a ton of it. I don't know if I told you that ever, but
I don't know if you ever did. Yeah, explicitly.
Yeah, there's a ton of sidechain compression to leave space for the bass guitar and the bass drum so that they're not kind of fighting with each other all the time.
Right.
And I could have made it pump like boom, boom, boom. Like you're hearing in this song, but that would be so inappropriate for a rock song. So, but here, I think that's part of the vibe, and that's intentional. It's not like, oh, they didn't notice. Like this is a great sounding track. I don't think it's an overlooked thing. But yeah, it certainly adds to the form, adds to the overall, you know, the sort of progression of different timbres that you hear. It's really cool. I'm glad you noticed it.
Yeah, it was distracting to the point where like I didn't pay attention to the lyrics at all on this first listen.
It's just a love song. It's just a love song. Yeah. I mean, there's nothing. Yeah,
I guess I got the general gist, you know, latching onto someone, kind of got that, kind of came through. But I mean, there's basically, I mean, for the amount of repetition throughout the track, there's surprisingly subtle changes in sort of timbre and orchestration.
Yeah.
And you know, we've kind of talked a little bit about this before, but you know, there's kind of the synth line acts as kind of the anchor, mm-hmm. and things kind of come in around it. Sometimes the synth sound is slightly different than it was earlier. There might be various things. There's kind of that pulse wave bass that's almost like a disco bass, but like kind of more choppy and weird that comes in and out. There's kind of that windy texture
in certain moments. Yeah,
I don't know if I could label specific forms, because it just sounded like constantly changing variations on a theme type of thing. But yeah, probably with the melody, there's probably like a more clear verse chorus type of structure to it. I didn't pick up on it the first time through.
Yeah, it's pretty much verse, pre-chorus, chorus times two. It's pretty much the whole song.
Okay. So the pre-chorus is when that windy, like white noise, pink.
Yeah,
noise,
when the drums kind of drop out. Yeah. And so that's another thing I wrote down, actually. So the producers of the track actually did put in noise. So in the pre-chorus, and when I say the producers, I mean Disclosure, like the guys who made the track. It was redundant. So yeah, Disclosure actually put in noise into the pre-chorus. So there's an amazing video online that you have to go watch of one of the guys from Disclosure breaking down the track. It's amazing to watch. It's like so cool to kind of see the creator break it down, and like you get to hear the individual tracks. You get to hear Sam singing without, and there's no auto tune on it. Like he's amazing. Like it's an incredible performance. But yeah, go watch that. So in that breakdown, he talks about how he put in a vinyl sound, that's so you get this crackling, and he put in an ambient street sound in the pre-chorus. So he was talking about how he wanted to give like a sense of place in that moment. And I don't know if it comes across that like you're standing in a street at night or something. Maybe that would come across more when you're in the club and you just came from, you know, standing out waiting to get into the club, right? That might come across better in the club. But regardless, I think it's a really cool effect that I would, me as a producer, I might be scared to do that because I always want to make sure things are clear. You can hear the melody, you can hear the chord, you can hear the bass, et cetera. But it works really well. Can we skip to that really quick and just listen to the moment where we get into that pre-chorus? I want to just listen to it to see how knowing what's in there changes our perception.
Yeah, for sure, for sure.
Because it changed mine. Like when I watched that breakdown, every subsequent listening, I've heard it differently. What I have found. So one thing that's interesting in sort of the second half of that pre-chorus, things start to get muddier and muddier, but I can't quite put my finger on why. And I think it's probably that noise track, like the street, because the vinyl crackling, you can hear that really easily and it has so much space that it doesn't really muddy things up. But I think the thing that is making things muddier is, well, increasing amount of reverb, but I think also that street noise might be getting put in, but I can't recall from the breakdown, but what do you think about that?
You get kind of almost, I don't know if this is done in production or just done with however they recorded the quote unquote street noise or pulled in, you know, a sample from somewhere. But there's kind of almost like a Doppler effect in terms of it kind of panning and coming in and out tremolo wise with the, you know, and if I'm not mistaken, it's also kind of built into the riser, right? Which might be kind of why you say it gets noisier and noisier. I feel like it's kind of setting up the, eventually you get like a filter sweep right before the chorus drops. So it's almost like it's kind of anticipating, and then you get the drop. So it is building up as part of the riser, just as an extended thing.
That's a great observation. I think you're right. I I'd have to watch the breakdown again. Because, like, right now, I can't hear street noise. Like, I don't hear cars. I don't hear walking on a sidewalk. I don't hear wind. So maybe it was, kind of parallel to the riser that's clearly in there, like the white noise. But anyway, I don't know. I think it's a really cool effect. And whatever is going on, it makes it sound really compelling. It's almost like a whisper that keeps getting louder. But it's still whispery, so you still have to kind of lean forward. And then, like you say, you get the drop, you know, the typical EDM drop where, you know, we had a break. Now, boom, time to start dancing again, right? Which is part of, you know, EDM as we know it today. And this kind of gets built into this pop track, which is pretty cool. So there's lots of cool orchestration, production things in there. But one thing I really want to talk about is just Sam Smith's singing. In that breakdown video that Disclosure put out, they claim that there's no auto-tune on Sam Smith's voice, which I buy. You know, they played the solo tracks of him singing. Doesn't sound auto-tuned to me, and he sounds incredible. And one thing that's really cool is sort of over the course of the transition from the verse to the pre-chorus to the chorus, and then the second half of the chorus, as a matter of fact, there is this gradual change in the processing of Sam's voice, and there's layering that is super effective. So in the verse, it's pretty dry. I mean, there's reverb, but it's just Sam. It's pretty much just Sam and a little bit of reverb. And then in the pre-chorus, the reverb kind of explodes. It's like he's singing in an auditorium, and then it comes back to really dry in the chorus, but it sounds, I always thought when I thought about this song in my aural memory, I always thought there was a ton of compression or processing or something on his voice, but it's actually just the master compression, I think. Because when Disclosure plays Sam singing just soloed, you don't hear that pumping. But when you listen to the chorus with everything in, it's like his voice is going right along with the kick drum in terms of that pumping that we talked about a minute ago. And so it sounds like his voice, like it sounds like the vocal track is incredibly compressed, but it's just the master compression.
Can you can you give us a snippet of the verse, a snippet of the pre-chorus, and a snippet of the chorus just for...
Yeah, great idea, great idea.
Like quick comparison.
Lift my heart up when the rest of me is down.
It's all Sam, baby. And then pre-chorus. I'm just going to keep playing it. I can edit stuff out.
Okay.
Are you enchanting even when you're not around?
If there are boundaries. Oh, yeah. Definitely not auto-tune, right? I mean, that was an intense slide.
If there are boundaries, I will try to knock them down.
And just a quick side note, I love that they didn't auto-tune it because it's very much a dance track. It's an EDM track for the club, but this just adds so much feel to the track, his singing.
Yeah, there's a lot of like you get like the guttural throat noise. It's like Adele almost, that's what comes to mind.
Yeah.
Especially at that moment at the end of the verse.
Yeah, definitely. And a lot of the pre-chorus little keys, those aren't quantized. So there's a lot of they put a lot of humanity into a song that's otherwise, you know, could potentially be really dry, right? So let's keep going.
I'm latching on, babe. Now I know what I have found.
Okay. You hear that foul, 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 foul.
I'm latching on, babe. Now I know what I have found.
Yeah, that all that beepy beepy key stuff, that's not quantized. And actually here, this is doubled. So that's adding to the space and the feel of like, okay, this is more processed. And his voice is kind of getting buried, right?
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, it's interesting. So it's doubled or even more than doubled, because I feel like it's also panned. I was hearing almost three iterations of it, at least. But yeah, it's so despite like the thickening of the vocal texture, it's being pulled back decibel-wise or volume-wise, which is really interesting.
Yeah, and so as we get into the chorus... you tell me what you think. Like, does this sound like the voice is processed a lot in the chorus? I kind of gave away the fact that it's actually not, but I just try to tell me how you feel it sounds, despite, you know, me kind of giving you the lead.
That's right. I forgot everything you said anyway.
What?
I forgot everything.
So it's doubled, right? But other than that,
at least doubled.
I actually know the exact number, but so what did you think? Like, did that sound like, okay, that's just Sam singing? I mean, it's doubled, but that's just Sam singing, or did you feel like there was a lot of extra processing with his voice?
I don't necessarily think there was extra processing, but I think there were a couple of things that came to my mind. One is that distance from Mike. It sounded like he was way farther back, so he's a lot less intimate, a lot farther back. So you get kind of almost like a room ambiance with the pickup.
Yeah, yeah, and I think you're totally right. In the verse, you know, right. So you're getting like him whispering in your ear, but then clearly as things get bigger, he's backing up. So inevitably you're getting more of the room, mm-hmm. and you're getting more intensity.
Well, intensity. Well, you certainly get. I mean, the kind of the shift in the falsetto, and kind of he's riding his break into the chorus, which I guess adds an element of energy.
Yeah.
I don't know. I get almost a Prince vibe with the way this is doubled versus what the pre-chorus was doubled. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree.
Partly, I think the way, and I'd have to look at this, or listen to it again, and maybe in headphones, but it might have to do with the way that the doubling's panned, or if it's panned and how it's panned.
Yeah, I think it's maybe panned 50%, 50%, maybe. That's kind of what I'm hearing, but
okay.
I don't know. But yeah, so I don't know if you agree with my theory that processed sound that is coming across is due strictly to master compression, because the kick is so loud that I think on the master compression, you're getting a reduction on every beat. Wah, 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 wah. And that line, da, do, da, ba, da, 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 right? He's singing straight quarter notes, more or less, right? So I think you're getting a pumping with the vocals because you're getting it on the master track due to the intensity of the kick drum.
So you think it's an incidental sort of effect?
I think it is potentially incidental, but rather than thinking about intent, I just want to point it out because I think it adds in a great way to the tune, and whether or not it was intentional or not, I think is, you know, interesting, but neither here nor there.
So it's another part of though that like that timbral rhythm is now entered into the vocal sphere.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good way.
Which is interesting too, because he's in his highest register right at this point in the chorus.
Yep. So the vocals are being doubled here in the first part, and I know that. So there's two or three vocal takes of all the same pitch, but then in the second half you get six Sams, and I think there's four singing the same thing and then an octave underneath it.
Oh, interesting.
There might be one where it's a harmony. I can't recall. But listen to the second half. It's so intense when you get all six Sams in with that pumping from the compression. It's so powerful. All right, so in part two of the video, we're gonna go over some music theory, some analytical things for the song, primarily dealing with the chords and the key that this is or isn't in. So stay tuned for that. There'll be a link in the description for that.